Okay, hello. So last time, we talked about the equation for an operator valued semicircular element. And yeah, I showed you that there is a unique solution which has the right positivity properties. And for this, we relied on a Banach fixed point theorem in analytic setting in Banach spaces. So this Earl Hamilton theorem, which says if we have a holomorphic mapping which maps the domain in a Banach space strictly into itself, which means the image has to stay away from the boundary, then actually we have a contraction, not in the norm coming, not in the Banach norm, Banach space norm, but in another norm which is canonically given in terms of analytic properties of this setting. So it's important that I have an analytic function. Good, and so we applied this to our setting, and I already wrote down the theorem, so maybe let me recall this. So this is 6.8. This is for us the main theorem. So this was proved by Bill Helton, Reza Rashidi Farhadov, about 12 years ago. Okay, and so the setting is B is a unital C-star algebra. Over which we consider our operator-valued elements. And then we have this second moment, which describes our semicircular. So this is a mapping eta from B to B. So this is in general a completely positive linear map. For this theorem, it's only important that it's positive, because I mean complete positivity plays a role if you want to have the same statements for all the matrix amplifications. Okay, so eta should be a positive linear map. And then we are looking for the solution of our kind of quadratic equation. And this we wrote in a fixed point form. And then, yeah, the statement is that for any element in the upper half plane, so for any fixed set in the upper half plane of B, there exists a unique solution to our equation in the lower half plane. There are many more other solutions, but only are interested in the one in the lower half. So there exists exactly one. One solution, let's say W, which is in the lower half plane of B, that's of course where Cauchy transform should be, to the equation. So Z times W is 1 plus eta of W times W. Okay, so this is an equation in B. So this is the one in B. Yeah, and of course, I mean, we are looking for the W, and then this is the G of Z, the Cauchy transform. Okay, so there exists exactly one solution, and maybe even more important is that we can get this by iterating our fixed point mapping. So this solution W, this W, is the limit of iterates, let's say Wn, where we apply the fixed point map corresponding to this equation n times to an initial point W0, and this W0 we can choose arbitrarily in the lower half plane. So if we start in the lower half plane, this map will always stay in the lower half plane, and it will also convert to something in the lower half plane. So this is for any W0 in the lower half plane of B. So it's really Banach's fixed point theorem. We just iterate and we converge to the fixed point. And it's independent from where we start, if we do this in the lower half plane. Good. Okay, and so this F set, so this was the mapping of W, which was given by Z minus eta of W to the minus 1, Okay, and that W is a fixed point for this map is the same as this equation. Good, and the proof of this, I mean, I already told it orally, or maybe, okay, the theorem is not yet finished. I mean, maybe, okay, let me write it down. We also wrote down the statements about norms of these solutions. So furthermore, we have that the norm of this W, so the solution, the unique solution of our equation, can be bounded by the imaginary part of Z to the minus 1. And we can also restrict the imaginary part of W, which is negative because we're in a lower half plane, so we can bound this away from the real axis. So this is less than minus 1 over the norm of Z plus the norm of eta. Eta is a bounded linear mapping because it's positive, times the imaginary part of Z to the minus 1, norm of this. Okay, this sum squared, and then the whole thing multiplied with the imaginary part of Z to the minus 1. Okay, so it's less than this, maybe times the identity operator. Okay, so we're really staying away from the real axis. Good, and of course, I mean, we did already the main work for proving this. So, I mean, we want to apply Earl Hamilton, and in the proposition before, we checked the conditions which we need for this. So the proof is now just applying Earl Hamilton. And the only maybe a little bit subtle point is that we do not apply Earl Hamilton to all of the lower half plane, because there we cannot guarantee that we stay away, that we have a strict mapping into the lower half plane. Okay, so we have somehow to restrict things by some norm bounds. Okay, and then we apply Earl Hamilton to those, but we have to choose this norm. So by Earl Hamilton, we know that so the lower half plane, but if we only look on the guys which have norm less than R, that this contains, if we choose the R big enough, then all the assumptions of Earl Hamilton's are satisfied. And we only have to choose the R bigger than the imaginary part of the inverse of imaginary part of Z. So for R bigger than the imaginary part of Z to the minus 1. So in the proposition we checked that under these conditions, this guy is strictly mapped into itself. And then Earl Hamilton tells us that this domain contains exactly one fixed point of this map f of z, which is the same as a solution to our equation. It has a solution to our equation star. And maybe, of course, we should, of course, note that f of z really is a holomorphic mapping. This is really the crucial thing in Earl Hamilton. But I mean, f of z is this guy here. And taking the inverse is holomorphic, and also this mapping eta as a linear bounded map is holomorphic. So this guy is really a holomorphic map. Good. Okay. And yeah, so we have exactly one fixed point, and the statement that we get this as the limit for any starting point. So if we have if we choose just an omega 0 in h minus of b, we just have to choose the r so big that this omega 0 is contained in this, and then we apply this statement to this hr, and then we know that the iterates of this converge to the unique fixed point. Okay, so given W0, we choose R such that W0 is in HR minus of B, which means we're choosing this R just bigger as a norm of this guy. So this means we choose just R bigger than the norm of W0. And then the Earl-Hamilton theorem guarantees that if I take the iterates of my function f set to the power n applied to omega 0, that this converges in this set h minus r of b to this w. And of course, if I make the r bigger, and I still converge, and I always converge to the same w, because it's a unique fixed point in all of those domains. It's the same, must be the same fixed point. Good, okay, and that's it. And I mean, those inequalities follow from the corresponding inequalities which we showed in the proof of the proposition. Good. Okay, so that's this. And now let me make a few remarks. First remark, of course, I mean the W which we get here must be our Cauchy transform. So that's clear. Because we have seen that the Cauchy transform satisfies this equation and it lies in H minus. So because there's a unique one, it must be the one which we get here by this iteration. So clearly, this solution W from our theorem, which we just proved, must be the value G of Z of the Cauchy transform. Of the operator, of the semicircle, of the operator valued semicircular element with the covariance mapping eta of our operator valued semicircular element S with covariance eta. Good. Then maybe a remark which I also made earlier, that of course for this theorem, I mean the eta, we require the eta here to be linear, because that's the situation which we have for operator-valued semicircular elements. But of course I can consider this equation also for more general eta, and of course what we need is that it is analytic, because that's what we need in Earl-Hamilton. Also, this theorem is also true more general. The linearity of eta is not really the issue here. It's the analyticity. And of course the positivity, so that it really preserves the spaces. So the linearity of eta is not essential for the arguments in the proof, for the arguments. So this means one can generalize this theorem 6.8 in the same way, or I can prove it in the same way to the case where this eta, I mean, is a map, it still must preserve the upper half plane, h plus to h plus, or it must preserve the lower half plane. And there it should be an analytic, is an analytic, and it should also be bounded, because in Earl Hamilton we also consider bounded analytic mappings. Okay, is an analytic. And bounded map. Actually, for Earl Hamilton, this guy has to be bounded. Okay, so I'm not. Okay, I'm not 100% sure whether I really need bounded here. So I mean, I have to. I need something which guarantees that this guy is bounded. But for this boundedness of eta. Okay. Yeah. So of course, if I say eta is a linear map, then I should also say it is bounded, because otherwise it might not be continuous and not analytic. Okay, but if I require already this analytic, then maybe boundedness is not an issue. Okay, but I'm not totally sure about this. Good, and then maybe the final remark is what we already addressed last time, namely how about the speed of convergence? So here, this theorem tells us that we get the solution of our equation if we just iterate our fixed point map, but of course there's no statement here which tells us how fast is this convergence. And of course, if we really want to calculate something, it's good to know whether the convergence really happens in a reasonable time or not. And the point is, we don't really have statements about the speed of convergence. And actually, in numerical calculations, it turns out that the speed of convergence might be very bad, in particular if the set is close to the real axis. And this means if you just use this right away, you might have problems of really getting the solution. But this usually can be repaired by improving a little bit your iteration procedure, by doing some averages. And this usually really improves things so that you really get a very good convergence to the solution. But we don't have a general theoretical statement which tells you exactly what the speed of convergence is and that it always will be improved. So this has to be observed in concrete examples. Good. Okay, so the theorem does not give estimates for the speed of convergence. I mean, it doesn't tell us what is the contraction constant in the contraction. And of course, if you go to the real axis, these contraction constants will get closer and closer to one. But we don't have concrete estimates. So in particular, for small imaginary part of set, so if you are close to the real axis in this upper half plane, the convergence can be very slow. But usually one can improve this. One can usually improve this by taking averages of the iterates. This by taking averages of the iterates. And for example, just averaging my 2 points, just the starting the W and the iterate. So for example, we could replace our iteration with the map f of z, so that's the iteration which we would do according to the theorem, by an iteration where we use instead a map g of z, which averages over the identity in W and this guy. So I'm taking 1/2 W plus 1/2 f of z of W. And then it's easy to see that this guy has the same fixed point as this guy, And I mean, essentially, with this, you ensure that you are not, you're still in a domain, so that you still converge to the right positive solution. And so, in principle, this is as good as this. But this usually has much better convergence properties. And somehow the idea is that here, maybe if your fixed point is here and you start somewhere, that somehow you are running on a cycle around the fixed point. And this would mean the next iteration would be here, and then the next maybe would be here again, and finally you would somehow go to the center here, but very slowly. But if you average over those two, then you are much closer to this guy here. So you win a lot by doing this. Yeah. Or maybe if this mapping, I mean, could also be that maybe it looks like a four cycle, then maybe it would be better to average over four iterations. Something like this. So this depends on the concrete numerical problem. But it turned out that very often such things improve things very well. Good. Okay, so this G set has the same fixed point. Same fixed point as the map F of Z. And it also maps this lower half plane strictly into itself, which means we can also apply Earl Hamilton to this guy. And maps HR minus of B strictly into its interior. And thus, instead of applying Earl Hamilton to this map, we can apply it to this map. And then again, the iterates, we know that the iterates converge to the fixed point. But the fixed point of this is the same as the fixed point of this. So thus, again by Earl Hamilton, the sequences, the iterates, under this map G of any starting point, and in N, converge also to the wanted fixed point of F of Z. Good. Okay, the point is they converge, but usually much faster. So, and usually faster. Okay, so that's maybe what I wanted to say about this. So this shows us that we have a good understanding of the operator-valued Cauchy transform of operator-valued semicircular elements. And we can solve in a good analytic and also numerical way for this Cauchy transform. We cannot write down explicit solutions, but still we have a good understanding of this. Good. Okay, now let me tell a little bit more about operator-valued guys, and in particular, looking a bit on what happens if I'm putting operator-valued elements into matrices, and talking a little bit more about the distinction between looking on matrices built out of semicirculars as operator-valued semicirculars or as scalar-valued semicirculars, because it's really the scalar-valued guys which we want. So in a sense, if I put three semicirculars into matrices, I get an operator-valued semicircular element, and this we understand quite well. But what I want is to understand this guy as a scalar-valued object. And so we should try a little bit to compare these two levels and see whether understanding one level also helps you to understand the other level. Good. Good, so this will be a small chapter on this relation, and this is also relevant for looking on matrices or block matrices. So I have matrices where the entries are Gaussian unitary matrices. Good. Okay, so this is section 7. So it's about matrices of semicirculars. So matrices where I put in entries which are semicirculars and compare this with what we call matrix valued semicirculars. Good. Okay, and the whole thing has some is related, of course, with the question: what can we say about block random matrices? Block random matrices, which I mean essentially matrices of GUEs. Good. So maybe let me start with the remark. I mean, we already have essentially seen. I have addressed this in one of the remarks that if I'm putting free semicirculars or combinations of semicirculars into matrices, I get an operator-valued semicircular. So let me just make this again maybe a little bit more precise. But we have already in 6.3, I mentioned this and essentially gave you the idea that our operator-valued free central limit theorem allows you to prove such things. So we have seen that matrices of free semicirculars are actually matrix valued semicircular elements. Okay, and we did this by starting with operator valued semicirculars over B and then putting this into matrices, and then we get semicirculars over matrices over B. But now maybe let me just take for B the scalars, which means that the entries I'm putting in the matrices are just ordinary scalar valued semicirculars, and then I get operator valued semicirculars over the matrices. So let me restrict here, this restrict here to the special case where I'm starting just with scalar valued guys. I mean, we could also do it more general, but maybe this is maybe the most interesting also for applications in matrices. Okay, so this means the entries. So the entries of our matrices are scalar valued free semicirculars. Okay, and let me write down maybe precisely the statement in this case, so next proposition, which I'm not going to prove, but maybe this is one of the assignments on the new assignments. In principle, we address this in 6.3. So it's more or less working out what I said in 6.3 for this situation here. Okay, so this is the following proposition. So we start with a scalar-valued probability space, so just an ordinary C-star probability space, let's say A and phi. So this should be a C-star probability space. So this means A is a C-star algebra and phi is a state. And there, I consider free semicirculars, let's say D of them. And so S1 up to Sn, this should be free semicirculars, and let me normalize them so they should be standard, which means the second moment is equal to 1. Free standard semicirculars. So standard means that their moments, I mean, in this case, of course, the second moment is just a number, just a moment, because B is here equal to C. Si squared is equal to 1. And now I want to put those guys into matrices in a linear way. And the matrices, let's say, should be n by n matrices. So this is fixed. So we're fixing somehow a size of a matrix. And then I'm taking, for each of my Si, I'm taking a matrix, which should have those this Si as entries. Okay, so this, so I have fixed N. And then I'm taking self-adjoint matrices. So self-adjoint B1 up to BD. So D is the number of S's which I have. And each of them should be an N by N matrix, an ordinary matrix over C. And they should be self-adjoint. Because we want to choose them as coefficients in those guys for building an N by N matrix, where the S1s up to SD appear as inputs. So this means I'm considering now S, which is B1 tensor S1 plus BD tensor SD. So this is in the N by N matrix over C tensor A, which of course we identify with the N by N matrices where the entries are coming from A. I mean, this is just the matrix B1 where I multiply each entry with S1. So this is contains S1 as entries. This is a matrix which contains SD as a matrix. So if I'm summing those up, I have an N by N matrix where each entry is some linear combination of the S1s up to SDs. And the linear combination is given by these coefficients. And of course, I want S self-adjoint, because we always want to talk about self-adjoint guys, which means, I mean, the S's are of course self-adjoint, but this means I should also choose those guys as self-adjoint matrices. Yeah, okay, and then the statement is that this S is now a semicircular element, but in the operator valued sense. So then S is in, let's specify the space in which it is operator valued or matrix valued. So is in the matrix valued C star probability space where those guy live, where this guy lives, which is just the matrices over A. So these are the N by N matrices over A, but the B is now just the ordinary N by N matrices. N by N matrices over the complex numbers. And of course, the conditional expectation from here to here is the usual one. I take just identity on the matrix level and phi on the A level, which means I have a matrix where the entries are from A, and then I apply entry-wise phi to each entry. And then I just get an ordinary matrix with complex numbers as entries. So this is a C star operator valued or matrix valued C star probability space. And S, S is an element in this space, and there the claim here is, so it is a matrix valued semicircular element. And of course it must have a covariance, which is a mapping from matrices to matrices, which of course is given in terms of the B's. So this covariance eta, which has to go from the matrices to the matrices, and this is given by so eta applied to a matrix, so B is now a N by N matrix, an ordinary matrix, is just the sum over Bj, B, Bj, J running from 1 up to D. So and the B's are the guys, the coefficients with there. They are also N by N matrices. Good. Okay, so this is proposition which in principle, maybe at least in example, we addressed in this remark, and maybe in your assignment you should prove this. So proof of this is in a new assignment, which should come up. Good. So this is somehow, not totally trivial, but it's more or less obvious from the structure of our whole theory. So it's just the setting that many things are preserved, structural things are preserved by going over to matrices. Huh? Freeness is preserved by going over to matrices, and also the notion of semicircularity is preserved by going over to matrices. Good, but the point is now that this S, this lives in this operator valued probability space, but we can also make this operator valued probability space, we can make this to a scalar valued probability space by also applying the trace here. And that's usually in what we are interested. Yeah? We want to understand this element not as an operator valued element, but as a scalar valued element. Okay, so we know, however, interested in this S, let's say, not as an operator valued element, where we understand it quite well, but as a scalar valued random variable, as a scalar valued random variable in, of course, what is the C star probability space? In the C star probability space, of course, the set is the same as before. So namely, I have the matrices, n by n matrices over A. But now I take not a conditional expectation onto n by n matrices, but a state which goes to the complex numbers, and which means I am applying also the trace to the matrices. So I take the trace tensor phi. Okay, and this means what we want is not really the operator valued Cauchy transform of S, but the valued Cauchy transform of S. Because that's, I mean, in this setting, we want the Cauchy transform with respect to this. So this means instead of the operator valued Cauchy transform of our element S. So this is the G of S, which is from the upper half plane in the n by n matrices, just ordinary matrix over C, to the lower half plane of the matrices over the complex numbers. B. Continue here. So where B of course goes over to identity tensor phi. So our Cauchy transforms are given by applying our conditional expectation to the argument minus the operator and taking the inverse. Okay, so that's the operator valued Cauchy transform. But instead of this, we want the scalar valued guy. So instead of this, we need the scalar valued Cauchy transform. Let me denote by little gs, which of course is now defined just on the ordinary upper half plane. So just the upper half plane of the complex numbers going to the lower half plane in the complex numbers. And the argument, let me now call it Z. This, of course, goes over to applying my state. And my state now, of course, is the trace tensor phi applied to Z minus S inverse. Yeah, good. But of course, going from here to here is something which can be easily achieved because you see, I mean, the only difference is this trace. So if I have this guy, I can apply the trace to this guy, and then I'm getting this guy. At least for the arguments which I have here, which I want. So this means the thing which I want, I can actually calculate it from the thing about which I know something. So note that for, let's say, set in the complex numbers, that's where I want to calculate this Cauchy transform. We clearly have that the scalar valued Cauchy transform is given by just taking the trace of the operator valued Cauchy transform. Maybe this is just g of s. And the argument here is set times 1. I mean, the operator valued Cauchy transform I can apply to more arguments, but here I just need the argument set times 1. And this says that if I can calculate the operator valued Cauchy transform, then I just have to take the trace to get the scalar valued. So if we can calculate g of s, we can from this also get the scalar valued. Yeah, okay, and I mean that's very often what we do in concrete examples, with random matrices. The operator valued guy maybe is a operator valued semicircular guy, so we have the equation which we can solve, at least numerically. We do this, of course we do this close to the real axis, because that's where we want this to invoke a formula, and then we trace and we get this guy. Good. Okay, so this numerically is very nice, but maybe it's also theoretically interesting, the question, I mean, what is really the relation between this and this? I mean, this is a semicircular guy, but how about this? So maybe first of all, one should convince oneself that semicircularity is not preserved by doing this. So that if I have an element which is semicircular in an operator valued setting, this does not mean that it is semicircular in a scalar valued setting. So, which really it makes sense to first consider things on this level, because being semicircular means that we know quite a bit about this guy. Okay, but maybe first we should really see this, because I mean, if and then maybe we should try to understand when is semicircularity preserved if we go down to the scalar valued level. Yeah, so let me make first this remark that it's not preserved in general, but we should see this in example. So, okay, but first remark 2 here. So note that being semicircular on an operator valued level, operator valued level, does in general not imply to be semicircular on a scalar valued level. Okay, and let us see this in example, just a very simple example, where we see it concretely, because we should see that something is not an operator valued semicircular guy. So, good, so let us consider 2x2 matrices where I'm putting in 3 semicirculars, so that I know it's a semicircular element over the 2x2 matrices. And so let me just choose diagonal matrices, and then there I'm taking the coefficients alpha and beta in R. So I'm just considering S just alpha S1, 0, 0, beta S2. So which in the language before is alpha 0, 0, tensor S1 plus 0, 0, 0 beta S2. So this is the coefficient matrix of S1. S1 only appears here as alpha S1. This is the coefficient matrix of S2. So S2 only appears here. In general, I could have linear combinations of all of them everywhere. So this is a very simple one. And part of, I mean, the special, yeah, the previous proposition tells me that this S is an, a 2x2 matrix operator valued semicircular element. And this is for all alpha and beta. So thus, S is for all alpha and beta an M2 valued semicircular element. Okay, and I'm claiming now that as a scalar valued element, it's okay, it's, it might be in some cases semicircular, but not for all alpha and beta. And so maybe how should we see this? Of course, what means semicircular? Semicircular means that I can calculate higher moments out of the second moment in a very precise way. Of course, it also means that the Cauchy transform satisfies some equation, but maybe here it's better just to check, let's say, the fourth moment. We know how the fourth moment is given. For a scalar-valued semicircular, it is just two times the square of the second moment, because we just have the two contributions from the non-crossing pairings. And we just should check that in this case, for most alpha and beta, this is not true. Good, so let maybe first we should calculate the second moment and then the fourth moment. So however, on the scalar level means I'm calculating moments with respect to the trace of the 2x2 matrices, tensor phi of on the S's. So on the level, so we have the second moment, and the second moment is now just a number. So I just have to take trace tensor phi of S squared. And of course, S squared is just on a diagonal alpha S1 squared and beta S2 squared. If I take phi of this, I get alpha phi of S1 squared, but S1 and S2 are standard, so this means the second moment is 1. So I get just alpha squared and beta squared, and then I take the normalized trace over this diagonal guy. So I'm just getting 1/2 alpha squared. Maybe let me write down first principle. I have phi of S1 squared plus beta squared phi of S2 squared, but those guys are 1. So I just have 1/2 alpha squared plus beta squared. Good. Okay, and so if this guy is semicircular, then its fourth moment must be given as 2 times the square of the second moment. Because the fourth moment is given by summing over the two non-crossing pairings, and each of them has as a contribution a second moment. So each block, which means each non-crossing pairing has as a contribution the square of the second moment, and I have 2 of them, so it's 2 times this. So if this S is, or would be, semicircular, then its fourth moment must be given by, of course, the fourth moment, this is just by definition, the trace tensor phi of S to the 4, but this fourth moment for a semicircular element must be 2 times the square of the second moment, which is the trace tensor phi of S squared. Okay, and the second moment we just calculated. Good, but so let's calculate now the fourth moment. So what is this? So for the fourth moment, we take S to the power 4. So I get alpha to the 4, S1 to the 4, and beta to the 4, S2 to the 4. And so I'm taking the trace over this. So this is 1/2. And then the sum over the elements on the diagonal. But on the diagonal, I have alpha to the 4. And I'm applying phi to to the diagonal. So I take phi of s1 to the 4 plus beta to the 4 to the 4. Good, those are semicircular, so the with second moment 1, so that their fourth moment is 2. So this here is 2. And this here is 2. So what do I have here? I have this 2 with a half. So what I get here is just alpha to the 4 plus beta to the 4. Yeah, but this should be the same as what I have 2 times the square of the second moment. And the second moment was, what was the second moment? Was 1 half alpha squared plus beta squared. So this squared, which is 1 half alpha squared plus beta squared squared. And this is equal to alpha to the 4 plus beta to the 4. This only happens exactly as equal to beta. As this is not. So this here only if alpha is equal to beta. Otherwise, this is the same. Okay, so this tells us here, so in general, so namely if alpha is not equal to beta, we have here an operator-valued semicircular element, which is not a scalar-valued semicircular element. But on the other hand, I mean, there are special cases that is preserved. We should try to understand better also why for alpha equal to beta it is preserved here. Of course, you see it more or less directly. We can formulate this in a more general way. Okay, so maybe, let me first write this down, and then I'm formulating a theorem which tells us when it is preserved. Because this is an interesting observation, which is quite helpful in some cases. So what we see from this, just to conclude this example, so we see in general semicircularity is not preserved by going from the operator value to the scalar valued level, but on the other hand it's not always destroyed, but there are situations where it is preserved, but there are special cases where it is good. And so we want to understand a little bit better what is the reason for special cases that it is preserved, and this is the next theorem. And there actually I will do it in a more general setting, because what I have done here is going from the operator value level to the scalar valued level. But I mean the scalar valued level could also be an operator valued level itself. So in principle I could have two subalgebras, not just one B, but another one, maybe I call it D, where D is maybe a smaller one, such that I have elements which I can consider at the same time as a B valued random variable and as a D valued random variable. And I know it's assume I know it's a semicircle on the B level, when does it follow that it is also a semicircle on the D level? What is there any good reason which would give us to us? And that's the theorem here. So let me first specify the context. So I consider C star algebras. So usually in an operator valued setting I have a B and an A, and now I also take another D. And they also should be sitting inside each other. So I assume I have D sitting in B, sitting in A, such that this A this BA is an operator valued probability space, and the DA is also one. And of course, the structure should fit together. So in such a setting, of course, I should have conditional expectations. But now I have one from A to B, and I have one from A to D. So with conditional expectations, So let's say I have one, I call it AB, EB, which goes from A to B. So an expectation between C star algebra, so it should be positive. And ED, which goes from A to D. And of course, they should be compatible in some sense. So as in the way as before, I mean, going down to the matrix level was taking identity tensor phi, and then going further was taking trace tensor phi. And of course, they are compatible in the sense that if I go down directly, I can do this in two steps. And this is also what we should assume here. So those two conditional expectations should be compatible, which are compatible in the sense that I compose ED with EB. This is the same as ED. So I mean, I have A, I have B, and I have D. So those are my subalgebras. And ED goes down from A to D. Okay, but then on this side, I can first go from A to B with EB. And then B, I mean, B is a subset of A. So there I also have the ED. I can now go with the ED from here to D. And this should be the same as this here, which is usually the case. I mean, for example, in what we had before, the ED was the trace tensor phi. And this we can say this is the same as taking trace. Okay, trace identity tensor phi. Good, so this is just the setting. But now, of course, we want now a semicircular element. So I assume I have those two operator valued probability spaces which fit together. And now I consider an element in A. An element in A, I can now consider it as a B-valued random variable or as a D-valued random variable. So consider, and I assume I know something about my element in B, so I assume it's a semicircular element. So I consider a B-valued semicircular element, which I call S. So this should be something in A. As a semicircular element, it has a covariance. So this covariance, this is a mapping from B to B, which of course is just a second moment. So eta of B, of course, is just E of B S B S. Okay, now the question is this S also a devalued semicircular? In general, it will not. But if we have a nice property of eta, then it will. And what is the relevant property? The relevant property is that eta of course, B, so in particular, in general, elements from B will be eta sends elements from D, again to D, then actually everything fits nicely together, and S is also a devalued semicircular element. So if we have that this eta applied to D, which a priori would just be in living in B, that this is actually living in D, then S is also a devalued semicircular element. and there's a semicircular element, it needs a covariance. Okay, and what is this covariance? Of course, it should be a mapping from D to D, and it should have something to do with eta, and of course it is what the only thing it can be, namely it's the restriction of eta to D. And this tells me that this really lands in the right space again. So with covariance given by the restriction of eta to D. So you see somehow it's the same kind of operator weld element. It has the same covariance. And maybe before I prove this, let us look again back on this example and check that this is really, that this condition is really what makes a difference here between alpha being equal to beta and not being the same. So, example. So let us reconsider this example from before. Reconsider example 7.3. And there, of course, we had a special case where the d here, was just the scalars there. So the second level, the lower level, was just the scalar valued level. So there we had that, let's say, d is equal to c. B are the 2x2 matrices over c. The ed, the conditional expectation onto the complex numbers, is just given by phi, and the EB, the conditional expectation, the 2x2 matrices, is the identity tensor phi. Okay, so that's just the special mappings and spaces which we have there. And so what we need is, of course, to look on the eta. So eta from B to B, in this example, is given by, so B are now the 2x2 matrices, so eta is a mapping on the 2x2 matrices, which we have to calculate. And then we can check whether it preserves the D, preserves the scalar numbers. Let me see, so what, scalar numbers or not. So eta, I should calculate it for an arbitrary 2x2 matrix. We do this. So this eta is given by, I apply my eta to a 2x2 matrix, and I call the entries B11, B12, B21, and B22. And what is this? So this is, by definition, I have to apply my conditional expectation, so identity tensor phi, to S times B times S. But what, so I have to multiply this S with the B and with this S, but the effect of the multiplication with the S is just that I'm multiplying an S1 from this side on S2 from this side, corresponding to the row and the column. So what I'm getting here essentially is B11, this is alpha squared S1 squared, B12 is getting multiplied with alpha beta S1 S2, the B21 is getting multiplied with beta alpha S2 S1, and the B22 is getting multiplied with beta squared S2 squared. Just multiplying this from the left with S and from the right with S, then I'm getting this. Now I apply identity tensor phi, which means I'm applying phi entry-wise, and the phi just acts on the S's, and phi of S1 squared and phi of S2 squared, of course, is 1, but phi of the mixed terms is 0, because those guys are free. So this means what I'm getting here is alpha squared times B11 0 on the off diagonal elements and beta squared B22. Yeah, so that's the general mapping eta. And now, in order to use this theorem, I should check whether eta maps our D to D. D is now the complex numbers, so eta is a linear mapping, so I just have to check eta of 1. Because if eta of 1 goes to C, then of course multiples also go to C. Now to check that eta of D is contained in D, we just have to see that, or whether eta of 1 is an element in C, or maybe C times 1. Good, so we should calculate what is eta of 1. So what is eta of 1? And the 1, of course, is the 1 embedded into the 2 by 2 matrices, so which is eta of this 1 matrix. Okay, and eta of this, according to this formula, so B11 and B22 are 1, so it's just alpha squared beta squared. Yeah. Okay, and of course this guy here is now a multiple of the 1 matrix exactly if alpha is equal to beta. Yeah, so I mean alpha and beta should be positive otherwise. Yeah, okay, maybe if alpha is minus beta, then it's still okay, yeah, because I mean minus S2 is still just another semicircular element. So maybe I should restrict here to positive alpha and betas. Or we can say this is exactly in our calculation. We also saw that we had the squares. So it's true if alpha is equal to plus minus beta. Okay, so maybe we can do it this way. So this is in the multiple 1 if alpha squared is equal to beta squared, which means alpha is equal to plus minus beta, which actually is also what we should have seen in the example before. Or I should have restricted to alpha and beta being positive numbers. Yeah, okay, so but from this we see that actually this theorem gives us the reason about what we saw before by direct calculations. And this is the typical reason that if something is semicircular on a B level, that it is also semicircular on a D level, because the covariance on the B level really restricted to D is a mapping from D to D. And then the semicircularity preserves. Yeah, we still have to prove this. Good. But maybe in this here, maybe just remark, as you see, the eta maps the 2 by 2 matrices, but what you get are always diagonal matrices. Okay, and the diagonal matrices are not always a multiple of 1, but of course you could take as your subalgebra D now the diagonal matrices, and you could take the conditional expectation onto the diagonal matrices, and then of course the eta restricted to this would map them into itself, because it always maps into this. So this means even for alpha not equal to plus minus beta, this guy will be a semicircular element, not over C, but over the diagonal matrices. So, because eta has this structure. Good, but okay, but maybe we should now prove this theorem. And of course, the point is to see we have a B-valued semicircular element, which means, for example, we know its Cauchy transform, we know the equation for the Cauchy transform. And we want to see that it is a devalued semicircular element. So we should see that essentially we get, again, the same formula for its devalued Cauchy transform. So this must be somehow preserved. So here's the proof. actually on the level of Cauchy transforms, because I mean we know how to characterize operator-valued semicircular guys. By the Cauchy transform, they have to satisfy this very specific kind of quadratic equation. So we have our two Cauchy transforms. So we have the Cauchy transform on the B level. Let me call it G. So this is G of B. This is the conditional expectation onto B of B minus S to the minus 1. And this is for all B in the upper half plane of B. That's our Cauchy transform there. And then, of course, if I consider S as a devalued random variable, then its Cauchy transform is, I denote it now by little g, g of d is taking the conditional expectation onto d of the same type of guy, namely d minus s inverse. And this I can do for all d in the upper half plane of d, which of course is smaller than this guy. Yeah. But now, as before, those two guys are related to each other. So, I mean, this guy here. So, first of all, the argument from here is also an argument here. So, if I'm looking at G of D, then the capital G of D is also defined. Okay, but so the relation, of course, is more or less as before. So first of all, the upper half plane of D, of course, is contained in the upper half plane of B. So I can look on G of D and capital G of D at the same time. And what is the relation? So G of D is by definition ED. But this ED, I can connect it with the EB by this compatibility relation. The conditional expectations are related. So I can also write this here as ED of EB of D minus S to the minus 1. Yeah, but this part here, of course, is now the Cauchy transform with respect to B. So this is just G of D. And so what I have here is ED of G of D. So in the same way as in the example before, where D were just the scalars. So the operator valued guy on level B, if I'm projecting this down to the D level, I'm getting the operator valued Cauchy transform there. Good. And now, I want to essentially, I know that this guy here satisfies the equation for an operator valued semicircular element. And what I want to see is that this guy also does this, the same type of equation. And the crucial thing is now to observe that this property, that D is somehow compatible with the semicircular structure, also goes over the Cauchy transform. Namely, this Cauchy transform here, G of D, this Cauchy transform here, of course, lies in the lower half plane of D. But this guy here a priori only lies in the lower half plane of B, but the point is to see that this also lies in the lower half plane of D, so that actually I don't need this conditional expectation. So this means all the things on the B level, if I restrict them to the D level, they are really lying in D. So this is the claim. So the main point now to see, so the main claim is to see that the Cauchy transform on the D level applied to an element in D also actually takes on values in D for all D in the upper half plane of D. So that's the thing which we have to see. Okay, if we have seen this, then we are more or less done, because let's assume we have this, because then we have that this g of d, which in general I get projecting the capital G down to d, I get it directly because I don't need to project down because this already is in d, if I have this claim. So then we have that actually this is the same as d for all d in h plus of d. And then, of course, the equation for this guy gives me directly the right equation for this guy. And then we have that. Okay, and then the equation for the g, which is b times g of b, is 1 plus eta of g of b times g of b, which is true for all b in the upper half plane in b. That's the fact that our s is an operator valued semicircle, circular element with covariance eta with respect to b. This equation, we can now restrict it to arguments which are in d, and then I mean those guys are just a little g. So this gives, this equation gives for b, I'm now choosing a d, which is in the upper half plane of d, then I have just d times, but the g of d is the same as the little g of d. This is 1 plus eta, and again here I have the little g of d times g of d. And this is now the equation for an operator-valued semicircular element on d. Because eta is now also mapping from d to d by assumption. Yeah, so this here, which shows that g is the Cauchy transform of a d-valued semicircular with covariance eta, but here just restricted to d. The same eta, but I only need the values on d, and it really from d to d. Okay, so this means the only thing I have really to show is that the operator valued Cauchy transform on the B level, if I just apply it to arguments from D, really lives in D. Okay, and this, I mean, there are various ways. I mean, you could look on the moments, for example. You could say the Cauchy transform, what I have there, the coefficients are moments, and moments are given by iterations of applications of eta applied, where I also apply my argument, but if the eta maps arguments from d to d, then you see that it really gives you the same as how you would calculate a d-valued semicircular element. Good. Okay, but I don't want to do it with the moments, but let us do it with the equation, because this also shows us somehow a nice feature of our knowledge about the solution of this equation. So I just want to use the fact that the Cauchy transform satisfies this equation, and I know in addition that eta maps elements from d to d. And then I want to know if I'm choosing this b here from d, does it then follow that the solution actually is also in d? And that's something which we can do. This follows essentially that we know that we get the solution by iterating. So this is now the proof of this claim. And yeah, what we know by our theorem 6.8 is that we get the g of d, which a priori is in the lower half plane of B, and we want to see it's in the lower half B, so we get this as the limit it's Wn is equal to f d to the n applied to W0, where we can choose an arbitrary W0 here. For arbitrary W0 in the right space, and the right space is the lower half plane of B. So I know g of d is the solution of this equation for g of b, but now I'm looking for g of d, where d is chosen from d. And so we know we can get it as the iterates, and of course this fd, this was just a reformulation of the equation into the fixed point form, so this is the corresponding fixed point mapping, so it depends on d, d is now an element in d, so this fd of w, this is d, this guy here, minus eta of w to the minus 1. Now the crucial situation is just to see that this mapping here maps also d to d. If eta maps d to d, so eta maps d to d, this here is in d, taking the inverse, d is a sister algebra, taking the inverse also happens in d, means if this w is in d, then this guy is also in d. So because of our assumption that eta maps d to d, we also get that this fixed point mapping maps d to d. So now, note that since eta maps d to d, the map fd also maps d to d. Good, but this means if I take as my starting point now something in d, and I mean I'm totally free, the starting point for my iteration. I just have to choose a starting point somewhere here, but of course in this upper half plane there's also the upper half plane of d, and I cannot choose my starting point. And then if I iterate, I will always remain in d. And I know this converges to my solution. Okay, this is sister algebra, so the limit is also in d. So this tells me if I just, because I know that I can choose any starting point. So I take this freedom which I have and choose the starting point in D. Also maps this to this. So hence, if we also choose the initial point of my iteration, the W0, not just anywhere in the lower half plane of B, but in the lower half plane of B, which of course is contained in the lower half plane of B, so I can also take those guys, then all iterates Wn, and thus also the limit, and thus also the limit of those guys, but this is just my g of d, they are in d. Okay, so this shows me, just by using, I mean, our analytic understanding of this equation, just looking on this equation, if I have this equation, and in addition the eta maps d to d, then I know that for arguments b, which are in d, the solution is also in d. And then, I have the corresponding equation there. Good, so this is a good... a good reason that if I go down from some level to a smaller level, I can preserve in some cases semicircularity. And maybe I just your final remark that of course what we are doing here has relevance for random matrix questions, because we know that we get free semicirculars as limits of independent Gaussian unitary random matrices, so the most important class of random matrices. And then if I'm looking on matrices out of semicirculars, this is then also the limit of matrices out of GUEs, which means I have block matrices, where not the whole matrix itself is a GUE, but I mean I have blocks in this matrix where each of them is a GUE which are independent. And then with this I can understand the limit of this. So I just want to write this down as a final remark, so I don't want to go more into the random matrices for now, but on the assignments we are comparing, of course, with what we do abstractly with random matrix calculations. So note the relevance of this for random matrices. So we know, for example, from the class last term, that if I have independent Gaussian random matrices, so let's say x1n up to xtn, if those guys are independent Gaussian n times n random matrices, so GUEs, then if n goes to infinity, they converge in distribution to a d-tuple of free semicirculars. Then we know, or if you don't know, you should look it up. You should watch some of the videos from class last term. So then we know that this tuple of the random matrices, this d tuple of the n times n random matrices for n going to infinity, converges to our d tuple of free semicirculars. Those are now scalar semicirculars, so in distribution, which means that any trace of any product on those guys converges to the corresponding tau of the corresponding product on this side. But this means, of course, that if I'm now putting my S's into matrices, that this is the limit of putting the X's in the same way in matrices. So, but this implies that if I'm now taking the corresponding combination of the X's as I did for the S's, so namely taking B1 tensor X1n plus BD tensor XnD, that this converges, if n goes to infinity, to the guy which we considered, which was this B1 tensor S1 plus BD tensor SD. Okay, and I mean, this here, of course, this is now a bigger matrix. I mean, those guys are n by n matrices, but I'm putting them into a little n by little n matrix. This whole thing is a n times n times n times n matrix. And I'm sending this to infinity. And this is a kind of block matrix. So I mean, those guys are fixed, the block structure. But those guys, the blocks are getting bigger and bigger. So this is a n times nn block matrix. And of course, I want to consider this guy not as an operator valued matrix over the size of this, but I want to consider just as a big matrix. And I want to understand its eigenvalue distribution, which means I want the scalar value distribution of this, not its operator value distribution. So I really consider this considered as a scalar-valued random variable. Okay, and of course this convergence here in distribution also means that I'm converging also with respect to the scalar-valued distribution. So this means this convergence here in distribution with respect to, I mean, scalar-valued on this side means that I'm taking the trace on the B's tensor, the trace on my n by n random matrices, and this converges on this side to the trace on the B's, tensor to phi on the S's. Okay. And I mean here I want to understand the distribution with respect to this, not with respect to identity tensor this. This would be easy. But with respect to this, which means on this side, I should also understand this as a scalar-valued guy. Because this means if I calculate the scalar-valued distribution of this, then this will be the eigenvalue the asymptotic eigenvalue distribution of this random matrix here. Okay, and I mean in some of the assignments, we are comparing those things with each other. But that's the relevance that I mean, if you are putting semicirculars into matrices, is nice. But it is also giving us possibility of dealing with putting independent GUEs into matrices, and thus talking about the asymptotic eigenvalue distribution of such kind of block matrices. Good. Okay. So I think that's enough for today. Thank you.